Hi, I really, really appreciate and grateful for being here. I thank a lot to DEFCON and IoT Village. So my title for this presentation is Defending IoT in the Future of High-Tech Warfare. Before beginning, let's imagine a robotic tank that maneuvers themselves across desert terrain, avoiding landmines, drones with enough artificial intelligence to carry out strikes without human operators, and next generation uniform to monitor soldier heart rate and hydration level or provide early warning alarms for chemical attacks. So if you Google the Internet of Things, you only find the attacks on it. Imagine how much more challenging it would be in an actual battlefield where adversaries want to attack the battlefield as opposed to a hacker in a home who just wants to have fun. So the 21st century technology boom can give armies a strategic advantage for high-tech warfare, but can technology make war safer? So my name is Harshit Agrawal and I am working as an RF security researcher. I will be joining Boston University to pursue my master's in cybersecurity this year. My primary research area include drone security, IoT security and telecom security. You can connect with me on LinkedIn, Twitter, or email me if you have any questions. So in this presentation, we will be looking at starting with the IoT as a transformational impact. Then we will look into Internet of radio vulnerabilities like car hacking or how we can sniff through radio frequency protocols. Then CIA triad for IoT security, IoT threat map. Then we will quickly look like how cyber recurrence can be done using the some IoT devices, electronic emerging tools for cyber recurrence, Internet of military things, and then autonomous weapon systems. So what do you think? A world where every device you own is communicating with each other to your daily task. You open your eyes in the morning and a device is telling you the whole list of tasks you need to perform today. Also, you give instructions through your mobile phones and your coffee is ready while you get ready for your office. So where CCTV cameras can identify and stop excessive force before it turns deadly, to wearing sensors which reports real-time health benefits to alert patient to emergencies before they happen. Even as drones, like which can be used to support first responder, IoT has transformational impact on our life across vertical sector. So there's a whole long list of tasks that IoT is helping us with. So we can say a world without IoT is living in a stone age. It may seem like a big claim for some of you, but when you see the bits of the IoT reflected in even mundane tasks of our daily life, you will agree to it. So how important is Internet of Things in our life? And even bigger question is how secure you think it is. So here in this slide, you can see the benefits of IoT are undeniable. IoT can bring much of the physical world from industrial assets to commodity devices to people into a connected ecosystem, which results in enhanced customer experience and better business outcomes. So increased connectivity and digitization in industry has produced an exponentially expanding attack surface behind which is safety, security, and critical services. So cars are turning into computer on wheels and airplanes have been flying data center. But this increase in power and connectivity has largely happened without designing inadequate security protocols. So for example, IoT can improve multiple aspects of an airport, such as like by regulating traffic flow and helping passengers navigate using Wi-Fi beacons, NFC tags and geolocation, or streamlining security checkpoints with biometrics like facial recognition, and reducing the number of lost bag using electronic luggage tags and sensor. And there are many more things. So given the potential and influence that IoT has on the world, it is worth looking at the security risk which is associated with this device. So in simple word, like if I define, the Internet of Things is a broad network of connected physical objects or devices which communicate with each other and exchange data without human interference. So generally, all these devices are capable of either collecting data, processing information, or transferring data. So IoT is wonderful in many ways, but unfortunately, technology has not matured yet, and it is entirely safe. So the entire IoT environment, like from manufacturers to users, still has many security challenges of IoT to overcome, such as manufacturing standard, update management, physical hardening, users' knowledge and awareness. So now, it is not only with our computer, but there are also things that interact with the internet without our intervention. And these things are continually communicating with the internet. A fridge sending an update of the food inside of our vehicle, transmitting message to the mechanic to inform its oil level. So there are whole lots of things which are happening in the world of internet. Now, let's consider this case scenario. In certain says, Sodan is like a guy who walks throughout the city and knocks on every door he sees. So, but instead of door, Sodan knocks on every IPv4 addresses. And instead of some city, here it is the entire world. So if you ask that guy about a particular type of door or about doors in particular part of the city, he certainly would know something and would provide you the information. So how many of those doors are open, who answers them and who whom they say? So Sodan give you the same information about these IoT items. Now how are they called? What type are they? And is there a web interface one can use? So there is no problem on knocking on door, unless you find out that there are a lot of door with no lock and no one can stop the bad guy from breaking in. So on other hand, like Sensis is also a search engine for the IoT, relying on the basic principle, but it's more precise when it comes to searching for vulnerabilities. Oh yes. Sensis can actually give you a list of devices with a particular vulnerability. For example, those vulnerabilities to heartbeat. So if it's an IP camera, you can see everything it sees, even control it if it supports something like that. And if it's a router, you can change its setting. If it's a baby monitor, you can talk to the boor baby in a scary voice. So it's all up to your moral standard, how you want to use this technology. So the main objective of security, like which is highlighted by various model, are known to be confidentiality, integrity, authentication and authorization, non-repudiation and availability. So implementing different cryptographic mechanism can help us achieve these security characteristics. Now, however, it is very challenging to implement this cryptographic algorithm to IoT devices. So confidentiality, which is the significantly sacrificed due to the constraint in size and power of IoT. So implementation of like public key interface can provide confidentiality and integrity. However, the encryption process with public key demands computational and memory resources that are beyond the capabilities of many IoT devices. Also, PKI requires devices to continuously update the certificate because like the certificate gets expired. So updating IoT devices is another challenge, especially in small devices which do not have any user interface. So moreover, some IoT devices are deployed remotely in inaccessible area and cannot be updated without human intervention. So authentication and identification of user in IoT is also significantly important. If an attacker compromises authentication, they can get access to the system as a legitimate user and can launch various further attacks without even being detected. So however, authentication has been another major challenge in IoT. Current authentication method require username, password, digital certificate, shared key or biometric credentials. So it is anticipated that IoT as privacy will remove many physical interaction medium through which like username or password are passed. So furthermore, like verifying identity can be challenging in the mobile environment of multiple IoT devices. So different users move their IoT devices through different architecture and infrastructure, which is provided by different service provider. So the issue of anonymity makes it difficult to achieve accountability. So to attain effective access control is another challenge in the IoT domain. And it is difficult to use well-known access control model such as role-based access control and attribute-based access control. for low power devices. So furthermore, like access control require the concept of authentication and identity, which is already a challenge in the IoT, as I said before. So ensuring like that each device has the control to maintain data confidentiality and integrity within an organization is necessary. In addition, investigation of IoT security along with data integrity holds practical significance in IoT development. So here in this figure, you can see like the security threat map of IoT. The Internet of Things spans nearly every organization and function. Associated edge devices now expose a series of vulnerabilities which can be exploited by all traditional threat actors. On right side, you can see Pyramid of Pain, which is based on Cisco IoT reference model, and it is evaluated from a vulnerability perspective of the IoT system. So the most vulnerable part of the IoT system with the least impact it suffered an attack is placed on the top of the pyramid. Sensors sit on the top of as they are the most vulnerable, being the most accessible part of the IoT ecosystem. The next vulnerable part is the communication between the sensor and accumulated data by the sensors. So the attacker can get access to this data through sensors or by getting into the network. Now then comes the hardware abstraction and firmware, which stipulate application programming interface. So for the interface between the application and the data. Lastly, the least accessible part at the bottom of the pyramid is the hardware platform such as like SOC, FPGA or DSP. So even through the hardware platform is at the bottom of the pyramid, it is the most vulnerable and desirable. So because it has the highest damage impact to a system in case of any attack. So it can be said that hardware is the foundation of the IoT ecosystem and most pain-causing part in case of any cyber attack incident. So therefore, IoT security should begin with hardware security. So it has been realized that true security of IoT devices can only be achieved by securing the underlying hardware of these devices. Hardware security begins with IC security and that is embedded in these devices. So backdoors have been reported in IC, which is used in weapon control system, nuclear power plant and public transportation system. So security is usually an afterthought in IC design and preferences is given to cost, performance and reliability in case of IoT. So here let's consider these two simple case studies. For example, at the Department of Defense fuel depot, tank level temperature and flow rate could be inexpensively and precisely monitored. So inventory usage and payment could be easily integrated with the backend business system. Now perimeter security, which could be enhanced with more inexpensive cameras and monitor sensors. So soil, water and air quality could be continuously measured for leaks or emissions. Now this tank and pipe corrosion and pipe vibration could be monitored to enable fixes before impending failure or any potential fuel related hazard. But imagine the havoc that could be caused by a malicious actor hacking into this IoT tank. If the typical IoT vulnerabilities are not addressed, tank level could be misreported, monitoring could be disabled, and malicious actor could dump fuel. So in similar way, the addition of internet capability, real-time situational awareness information can be relayed to command and support facility remotely from the battlefield. But if enemy takes advantage of vulnerabilities in such devices or networking or even compromised devices, it may allow the enemy to provide false information to the warfighter and the supporting remote organization. So clearly, it's important to prioritize addressing the highest risk vulnerabilities which are already installed in mission systems, such as like ensuring that the information is encrypted when where needed. We implement the policies and processes and also communicate these changes broadly. So to ensure like supply chain management of a broader array of potential devices that could be deployed with our troops. So let's see some RF based IoT attack. So what basically lies inside the radio wave spectrum? The following frequency allocation chart here. So various commercially used devices with their application and frequency based on data from NTIA and FCC. So the electromagnetic spectrum, which is divided according to the frequency of these devices, which are measured in hertz. We can see here, like FM radio is operating somewhere near 100 megahertz, the GPS and cell phone somewhat near 900 megahertz, while ADS-B signals on frequency 1090 megahertz, which can be directly captured from RTL device, or which can be captured from RTL device and 2.4 gigahertz band, which is used by more than 300 consumer devices. So including like microwave ovens, cordless phone and wireless network like Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. So invisible and ignored, our devices are currently screaming out large amount of information about us, our habit, our pattern of life to anyone who cares to listen. So let's see some example like what is commonly being broadcasted and what can be done with this information. So in this very first example, you can see a simple implementation of FM transmission on GNU radio. One can easily broadcast live. Or in this example, you can see here I'm using the GPS HDR stream library, which generate GPS baseband signal data stream, which can be then converted to RF using software defined radio platform, such as like Blade RF, Hec RF or USRP. So here, like basically the user specifies the GPS satellite constellation through a GPS broadcast FRMIS file. Now this daily GPS broadcast FRMIS file, like which is short form for BRDC, is a merge of the individual site navigation file into one. Now the archive of this daily file can be downloaded from the NASA site. Access to this site is free and require the registration. So this file are then used to generate the simulated pseudo range and Doppler for the GPS satellites in view. This simulated range data is then used to generate the digitized IQ sample for the GPS signal. So later that can be transmitted using the Hec RF to spoof the location. ADS-B signal, which is a surveillance technology in an aircraft, determine its position via satellite navigation and periodically broadcast it. So this can be enabling to be tracked. This signal can be tracked using low cost devices like RTL in this example, and I am using the RTL 1090 and virtual radar to track planes. So using GRGSM like and calibrate command, we can listen to IMSI number and further decrypt the A3A5 algorithm to listen into calls and messages. So every mobile phone has an IMSI, which is like International Mobile Subscriber Identity number. This number is unique to every SIM card, and this number is shown on every mobile phone which is connected to the IMSI catcher, and the police can determine your identity easily through this unique number. And there is no way you cannot be victim except you are in an area with the no IMSI catcher. So in this example, you can see a simple example of replay attack, which is like a good POC, but this does not provide much of a learning opportunity, nor did it drastically reduce the effectiveness of the security system. So it only provides false in alarm of standard functionality. So definitely, like after this, there were so many different case scenarios which are being presented in DEFCON and Black Hat, like car RKE for a roll jam attack, or after roll jam, like there was one more attack which was published in the DEFCON. So when you find a signal of interest, whether this signal is of your interest or that should not be present in a particular frequency band, you should want to start with the basics. So the first step is to look at the frequency bandwidth and shape up a signal of interest to get an idea about the characteristics and therefore the identity of this signal. So for example, many of the 3G and 4G signal have square tops due to the type of filtering they use. And also this commercial wireless signal use predictable bandwidth. So you can make an educated guess on the signal type based on what you see on the screen. The second step is to perform modulation analysis of the signal. So analyzing the modulation will give further insight into more or unique characteristics of a signal. The third step is to capture the signal data and perform additional analysis of the signal. So this can be difficult technique because based on some experience, trial and error, it would be used within the RF environment software capabilities to try to determine more characteristics of the signal. So for example, you could look at the RFIQ versus time to figure out digital modulation symbol rate, or look at the spectrogram to try to check for the preference of OFDM subcarriers. So there are many different vulnerabilities which are related to Internet of Radio. We all know that Wi-Fi uses radio to communicate, but so does the other 99 protocol that make up the world of mobile, cellular and Internet of Things. So all these new radio enabled devices bring with them new invisible threat. Now enterprise will need to be able to react to new threat which are entering the environment through the Internet of Radio. So there are examples like sniffing, war driving, evil twin attack, replay attack, then jamming or physical layer protocol abuse. So we often hear about the dangers of dark web, but Internet of Radio is not merely dark, it's invisible. So any wireless network which is going to have a few security risks, so it is important to address them. The first issue is the fact that the sensors are broadcasting all the information they have continuously. So here you can see, like, NATO has now designated cyber as an official domain for warfare. So in a press conference in 2016, NATO allied minister formally agreed to include cyber operation in its war domain along with air, land and sea operation, and to amplify the defense of its computer network. So declaring cyber as an official domain of warfare allow NATO to improve planning and better manage resources for cyber defense operation. So in 2014, NATO stated that a cyber attack could rise to the level of military assault and trigger Article 5 protection, which means like that NATO could respond to a cyber attack with conventional weapon just as they would do for air, land or sea attack. So cyberspace will remain a contested space for the foreseeable future. Now NATO decision to declare cyberspace an official domain of warfare is an important step in the right direction. So the militaries face a new reality, one with multi-domain challenges. Now the way military build its forces, integrate its planning and synchronize its operation must change quickly. So in modern military lingo, there are five interrelated domains, which includes land, maritime, air, space and cyberspace. So the cyberspace domain is wholly man-made and is ever changing. So in the emerging multi-domain reality, an attack will often come from the multiple domains simultaneously, like jamming of radio and data link, or persistent surveillance and precise long-range fire. So there are many things like which can happen in cyber space. So there's a famous quote from the book Art of War by Sun Tzu. There are not more than five musical notes, yet the combination of these five give the rise to more melodies that can ever be heard. There are not more than five primary color, yet in combination they produce more hues than can ever be seen. There are not more than five cardinal taste, yet combination of them yield more flavors than ever can be tasted. So now we can imagine about the result from convergence of ground, airborne, naval, space and cyber. So here you can see the modern military forces rely heavily on a variety of complex high technology electronic warfare and defensive capabilities. So traditionally, cyber and electronic warfare were distinct entities. Cyber warfare involves the action by a nation state or international organization to attack and attempt to damage another nation's computer or information network through. So for example, computer virus or denial of service attack, the military has already designated cyber as the fifth domain of war along with four physical domain. So and it's mulling making the electromagnetic spectrum the sixth domain. So cyberspace operations are the employment of cyberspace capabilities where the primary purpose is to achieve objective in or through cyberspace. So far, like EW has been a sleeping beauty, hidden away and forgotten for a generation. But now it is a dragon about to be reawakened, and NATO leaders who continually try to ignore its significance do at its alliance peril. So in convergence of electronic warfare, IoT based attack, computer network exploitation within the radio frequency spectrum, it describes how the integration of IP capabilities in systems using radio frequency for communication provides attacker the ability to exploit systems on isolated network. So unlike current cyber and EW protection teams, which are focused on vulnerabilities within their respective areas, and adversaries which are focused on achieving desired effect and end state goals, this threat is highlighted by oversight in software and communication systems, which are developed in recognizing vulnerabilities introduced during the integration of hardware and software. So definitely, like digital technologies have transformed warfare. Beginning with the emergence of network-centric warfare in 1990, digital technologies have become the basics of weapon, tactics and strategies. So today, warfighters use connected devices to coordinate air strikes on the battlefield. Drones are controlled from thousands of miles away, while commander watch real-time video of streaming from the battle space, and logistics and broader supply are regulated and managed by complex digitally technologies. The next generation of these emerging technologies, such as artificial intelligence and smart drones and robots, additive manufacturing will make the US military even more dependent on digital technology. So further, much like any disruptive or transformative technology, there can be little doubt that the IoT is altering the way armed services conduct operation and coordination across forces, like joint and coalition. So the modern concept of command, control, and communication and intelligence, which is C3I, is driven by the information technology that is deeply embedded in advance in military armament, which demands high efficiency in decision making and control. So one might consider C3I as the brain of modern warfare. Now, if C3I systems are considered the brain, then battle space sensors and actuators, the internet of battlefield things, are the eyes and ear, and military maneuver the hand and feet. So if it is the preservers of IoT devices that will essentially make the eyes, ear, hand and feet inseparable from the brain. So we often think command and control as a distinct and specialized functions like logistic, intelligence, electronic warfare or administrations within its peculiar method. But in fact, command and control encompasses all military functions and operation, given them meaning and harmonizing them into a meaningful whole. So done well, command and control add to our strength. Done poorly, it invites disaster and even against a weaker army. So command and control help commander make the most of what they have: people, information, material, and often most important of all, time. So let's see some cyber reconnaissance case studies which are based on IoT devices. So now it's time for cavalry to get serious about this cyber reconnaissance. The whole art of war consisting of understanding what is on the other side of the hill. So in this new world, much of the information essential to effective tactical decision making may appear in cyberspace long before it is extracted through the dangerous and painstaking process of air and ground reconnaissance. So such an important shift require a reframing of our traditional approach to reconnaissance. So is it now necessary to expand the concept of military reconnaissance to include the cyber domain? If so, how should such a capability be organized in the military? Who should do it, and what are the hazards with such an approach? So the incidents like in Israel and Gaza presents a compelling case. Relatively minor tactical actions like the movement of a military vehicle or the firing of a single rocket now have an undeniable fingerprint in cyberspace. So that fingerprint is visible to anyone with the persistence, tools and training to view it. This presents a new way of seeing the battlefield, finding rocket launches and anti-rocket weapons on the battlefield in real time has traditionally been the vocation of reconnaissance formalities. So now those reconnaissance organizations must develop new way of developing that information into the cyber domain. So future reconnaissance organizations that are trapped with the ability to merge ground and air collection with these type of capabilities in cyberspace will possess a competitive advantage on the 21st century battlefield. So we can definitely say like the crowdsourced surveillance in the future of internet, like by 2030, more than 125 billion computer sensors and IoT devices will be connected to the World Wide Web. Now roughly 15 for every devices will be connected to connected and for like roughly 15 for every person alive. So by that time, nearly 80% of the data moving on broadband network will be video. It is reasonable to assume that these trends will combine to create a ubiquitous network of crowdsourced surveillance, where nearly every event in public space is recorded and uploaded to the web by private, commercial or government actors, which are like through the commercially owned IoT devices. So let's see some case studies. Here, a modern equivalent of the World War II era warning that loose leaf ship sinks. So maybe FFS don't share your Fitbit data on duty. So let's consider this interesting case study where the fitness data company Strava recently came under fire when it was discovered that its global heat map, which aggregated millions of geo-tracked devices, inadvertently revealed the location and outline of US military bases in conflict areas. So with this incident provides a useful reminder about the importance of operational security. It reveals a much more valuable message about the future of route reconnaissance as a military operation. So moving a large military force over unfamiliar terrain presents a formidable challenge. So as a result, reconnaissance formation have traditionally needed to recontour ahead of the main body to assess the trafficability of routes. So like Strava, modern digital map application on most smartphone use a process of extracting location from cell phone tower to determine rate of movement along roadway. Over time, this anonymized data provides a useful pattern that can show where vehicle traffic is unrestricted. It can therefore be a powerful tool to augment the often dangerous task of ground route reconnaissance. So in addition, like when merged with ground moving target, indicator target, we can like use analytical tool to distinguish between military and civilian vehicle movement. So many locations of like military and intelligence agency bases had already been previously revealed through many other publicly available IoT databases. But the bigger worry from an operation security standpoint is how activity data from IoT devices could be used to identify interesting individuals and track them to other sensitive or secretive locations. So history suggests that many of the most significant advances in military technology began first as commercial technology, like radar, for example, was originally developed as a tool to avoid ship collisions during limited visibility. But now it's highly sophisticated for defense purpose. So these emerging categories of cyber tools like social media, GPS enabled IoT devices, satellite imagery database from publicly repository like a digital globe, which estimates to retrace a data set of 100,000 terabytes, are already available in commercial market. Date with adaptation might provide a real advantage to cyber recons formation. And the biggest dangers may come from potential adversaries figuring out patterns of life, like by tracking and even identifying military or intelligence agency personnel as they go out about their duty. So too often we think like secret lie hidden, when now they are mostly out in the open. Both military and the public need to come with grips with the fact that the era of secret is arguably over. So digital eyes in the sky were already used in Iraq and Afghanistan by military forces to find IED bomber. They were used in a Baltimore city to find murderer. So a high resolution camera, which you can see on the top left image, is placed in a casino, or long duration drone in the city is filmed. So that one pixel is one person. The pixel of a person can be highlighted and tracked. So then all these events in the field of view are tabbed and recorded. So let's say when an event of interest happens, this recording is rewound and any physical interaction with that point can be traced. So But with this fast pace of technology, you can see like equity parallel camera pictures on the right side, which shows stunning clarity of camera systems can zoom onto a specific area of a larger space. So a small bike rider or store window sign can be amplified so dramatically that it can read the fine print. So each 50 megapixel camera could, if it can track a location of 100 km by 100 km, so about 1000 high resolution such camera array could cover the entire USA and China. So and with swarm drones and cameras arrays, it would make relatively cheap to perform something like this. So the focus, let's see what are some of the things like which are related to Internet of Military Things. So previously we had Internet of Things, Internet of Consumer Things, Internet of Ransomware Things, and Internet of Military Things. So here, like, what does B stand for? So the focus of Internet of Battlefield thing is to provide situational awareness of the battlefield utilizing a network of interconnected sensor, actuator, and analytical devices. So sensor could detect enemy movement and then relay that information in real time to analyst, enabling them to make tactical decision on positioning, areas to avoid, or who is crossing a certain area. So this capability would potentially save resources and soldier life, making IoBT an important topic for the defense to investigate. And of course, like, there's a lot of buzzwords surrounded by the Internet of Things and Internet of Industrial Things. But the big focus of the army is creating another buzz term, adding the B in there. So adding the battlefield as part of this. So for me, it's always being embedded devices. Like, we are talking about event security in embedded development. The big difference, of course, with all these different terms is what you are using them for. And oftentimes, like, the mission and that people are using them for don't vary that much. But in this case, we are talking about very extreme environment. Environment that have very hostile and downright adversarial. Not to say that all other types of area devices are not being tracked or attacked daily. Either targeted and attacked, often in locations where they are extremely vulnerable, people literally can woke up and do extremely whatever they want to do. And of course, like, the physical environment. So the Internet of Military Things encompasses a large range of devices that possess intelligent physical sensing, learning, and actuation capabilities through either virtual or cyber interfaces that are integrated into systems. So these devices include items such as like sensor, vehicle, robot, UAV, human wearable devices, biometrics, munitions, armor, weapons, and so many other smart technology. So the vision of a connected battlefield where soldier interface with a myriad of sensor, weaponry systems, and support systems and adapt the information to gain situational awareness and force superiority introduces a new series of threat at a greater scale and then any other time in history. So each connected device now becomes a target for the adversary and a chance to exploit weakness in not only the devices themselves, but also the network interconnecting these devices. So the key technology trend impacting the IoMT theme over the next 12 to 24 months include AI, sensor, processor, transmitter, and health monitoring system. But above all, security presents one of the most critical aspects to the IoT deployment. So however, in providing security solution, suppliers have had trouble going beyond their traditional domain. For example, operators IoT security offers have mostly been avoid about devices authentication and network reliability. So clearly, breaches can occur at the device level, network layer, app level, storage level, or the data level. So quickly here you can see there are so many different kind of sensors which are related to the IoT. Now sensor technology is evolving fast, like EO or IR sensor, radar, sonar, motion, or sound detectors have their capabilities augmented as the technology they incorporate improves. So for example, IO or IR sensor can see further at much tougher climatic and atmospheric condition, whether it is a day or night, compared to just a few years ago. So phased array radar can simultaneously collecting intelligence in the land, maritime or air domain without losing range coverage or accuracy. So let's see like how some of these sensors like IoT based sensors can be used in the battlefield. So let's say if we take the example of microphone or the sound sensor, so it can like pick up potential languages that are considered hostile or friendly, like to identify different type of weapon sound, could check the weapon data phase to match potential guns that match a certain group of people, or it can like calculate noises in the distance or how certain threats could be. RFID can be used like to confirm the allies that are passing by, because RFID would be assigned to all soldiers. Again, camera like which are low quality used for discerning color patterns of uniform, or high quality camera would be able to take a snapshot of object moving in the field of view. So limitations would be like we can consume significant battery capacity to start up, store and send images. Again, GPS can be used to track location of sensor, registering event, or could also be able to activate sleeping nodes if a specified path has been identified. RF sensors like can be used to track radio frequency over the area of interest, sensors to detect heat signature and notify the other sensors to start collecting information. Sensors can be used to detect vibration and stress which are experienced by the sensors and generate electronic charge based on the stress. So identification of friend or foe, or used by the military currently in conjunction with radar to discern friendly and civilian vehicles and military units. So ultrasonic sensor, which can be used to trigger classification sensor to start collecting data to help determine ally or adversary. So there are so many different kind of sensors which can be used for different purpose in the Internet of Battlefield environment. Now modern day soldiers are entering the battlefield not only with weaponry but also with an electronics command and control center built on the sensor, antenna and communication capabilities of the Internet of Things. So the combination of multiple radio, wearable like smartwatches and glasses, biosensor, GPS equipment and communication devices are just some of the gear which are arming soldier with life-saving information and creating unprecedented visibility into their surroundings. So our current and future soldiers are only as good as the communication that is shared with them. So the sharing of the information wins the fight, not the biggest or best bullet. So we are looking at a soldier as a communication intelligence platform, not just a person with a weapon system. So work is underway on new intelligent body gear that among other things include onboard computer that allows soldier to chat online during missions and to tie into key defense network to tap into intelligence. So soldier will also be able to share information like mission data, watch mission related video clips and even exchange surveillance intelligence with nearby military vehicles. The onboard computing power will also monitor the soldier's psychological status via biosensors to provide a clear pictures of their vitals or performance. So of course, the key to this vision of a connected soldier is the connectivity itself. So yet there are numerous communication and networking obstacles related to the harshness of the battlefield and the density of the radio frequency environment. So hundreds of control communication computer and surveillance systems bound by thousands of antenna sensors and RF circuit are vying the RF signal with a limited RF spectrum. So as we go down the path, the connected soldier, the design problem becomes a lot more complicated and the design space the much more harder, because there are much more sensors and not just radar or frequency. So all of a sudden everything is connected and you have many proliferating systems. So there is no free lunch. So high data rate equal to extra soldier battery load and consequences hovering, however, of opening up your system for sharing, upgrading and accessing in order to make it relevant to data rich. E-battlefield of the future is that you open it to a whole host of new threat and risk. So the one that we all are familiar with in the online world, in which we all now live and increasingly rely on. So I love that I can unlock my phone with my face and that Google can predict what I'm thinking and that Amazon knows everything what I need. So it's great that I don't have to hail a cab or to go to the grocery store. Actually, I hope I never have to drive again or navigate or use case or clean or cook or learn. But what if all of this technology is misused? The same technology which is making our life easier is being weaponized. The feature that unlocks your phone with your face, what if it is attached to a self-learning machine, a gun? Its manufacturer, Kasnikov, few months back shown in a video like how gun using object recognition software can easily identify target. They say it gets more accurate the way more we use it. So that drone, which is like advertised to get some awesome panoramic shots, can be used to carry small payload or grenades. This drone comes with a high explosive warhead which hangs out in the sky until it finds an enemy radar systems, then fires on it. Oh, and what about that driverless car you thought was so cool? So here it is in a form of a tank like Russian army warfare. It's called the T-14. So one of the big concerns about such swarm is the misuse of autonomy and just how much real control the operator have over their actions. So far has always been a human behind every kill or no kill decision. So let's review some anti-drone systems that are used to detect and neutralize the drones. So more than 400,000 drones are sold each year worldwide, which means a potential threat for society and critical infrastructure. Illegal filming of secret objects as well as personal privacy is very common. So the airspace stays unprotected from the drone. Growing need for anti-drone solution worldwide lead manufacturers to develop the anti-drone system. So applicability of drone detection and identification method depend on the requirement mandated by real life scenarios. That being said, we observe that methods other than RF sensing cannot be solely relied to detect or identify intruding drones. So on one hand, like radar, vision and acoustic bait method can be restrained in various ways, such as like using stealth technology, changing the drone physical shape and rotor, using low noise rotor and by emitting natural sound like bird chirps or white noise. So in addition, such method require expensive equipment like high quality video cameras that is not designed to detect drones. Moreover, Wi-Fi based drones methods are inherently limited as they cannot detect drones operated by other wireless technologies like 4G. And they require knowledge of the drone Wi-Fi parameters like protocol and channel number. On the other hand, we see that RF sensing based methods for drone detection and identification are adequate to be used in real life scenarios. So such methods are independent of the wireless technology which are utilized by the drone. So like if whether they are using Bluetooth, 4G or Wi-Fi and are immunable to physical alteration and differences among drones. So however, current methods are still not fully automated nor robust due to the lack of a large label database for the drone. So let's take this simple example. If we consider like the security threats from IoT based drone for an airport, so there are like passengers and visitors, aircraft, cargo, air traffic controller, parking carriages, which are all vulnerable to drone attack. So there are like surface movement radar which are installed on the airport. This radar system detect aircraft and vehicle and plot their location in real time on a map which is displayed by a computer screen. So an example is the airport surface detection equipment which is like ASDEX. So it consists of a radar, multi-rotation technology and satellite to enable air traffic. But one of the concern for the concept of operation is that the SMR will have shadow areas in the airport due to building and other airport infrastructure. So if this occur, then the drone can fly in a path behind the buildings and avoid detection by the ASDEX systems. So this is because the SMR signal is scattered by the building. Anything in the shadowed area will not be detected. So using an approach like to overcome this limitation is to use low cost short range radar which are based on IoT and can be divided in a multiple swarms. which can be placed in the shadow area of the airport. So this will allow the increased detection of drone. Furthermore, if the data from ASDEX radar is unavailable, the SOS can still deliver value by detecting drone using the low cost SOT range radar. So furthermore, it will also increase the range. And another example could be, like, it can definitely help the ATC. Like, previously we had air traffic controller, that can be now changed to unmanned aircraft systems traffic management. So in that way, like, the potential threat through the IoT based drone, which are like flying through the GSM, using GSM signal, which are very hard to track, can be easily tracked with this. So while the military has been a driver in connected in machine-to-machine communication, such as radio frequency identification, it has been slow to adopt true IoT application that need this communication into interpolable automated cycle. So the challenge is that defense leader wishing to take advantage of the IoT face a complex technological and regulatory landscape that threatens to mire their efforts in endless choices and challenges. So the army has done a lot of work on system that can work without a constant internet connection to get around this. But because they are not linked to the internet, they have limited utility. But all this expanded connectivity and technology brings a host of risk too. So for one, creating Wi-Fi enabled uniform and weapon could give enemies many new digital target. And if malicious hacker can manipulate sensor to fake a chemical attack, those false signal can be deliberating. So then and now, it is hard to overstate the importance of information to military commander everywhere. While the rest of the world was waking to the internet in 1996, the military, for example, was already outlining the plan for information superiority. So with this information so central to all activities, we can see, like, what are the potential hazards and what are the vulnerabilities which we need to address in the internet of battlefield. So here you can see, like, some of the references which I have take the help of to develop this presentation, and I'm really thankful to them. And guess if you have any questions, you can reach out to me on my either by Twitter or LinkedIn, or you can drop me an email. Thank you so much.